Welcome back at WNST, Towson, Baltimore, and Baltimore Positive. Don Moeller and I getting together. You know, this is such a good idea, right? I said to Don, it's going to be the holidays. We're all full of gratitude and Thanksgiving. My wife and I are getting away a little bit, and I want to have some really cool, spirited conversation heading into 2020, some real Baltimore Positive stories. And we're putting together some individual segments, and this one's kind of interesting because this is someone that you know very well, and I only really know her as Michael Phelps' mom, and I probably should listen to her because she's a teacher and
a principal.
She would have been a tough teacher if she were my teacher. And now I see her at cocktail parties once in a while, and it's always good that somehow, some way, you and I wind up somewhere with a plate of food talking about life and stuff. Debbie Phelps, welcome in, the executive director of the BCPS Foundation and the Education Foundation here in Baltimore County. And I know you guys know each other well, so I'm just going to sit back and let you guys have
Well, Debbie, we go way back, but one of the reason you're on today is that Nestor and I are committed to talking to the people who I always put in quotes who are doing the work, the people out there with their organizations making a difference. So because it's so easy to be negative and talk about what doesn't work, and Nestor and I know that there are literally thousands of people making a difference, and you and the foundation are doing that. So welcome.
Thank you so much for having me. It's an honor and a pleasure to be with you.
Well, we would just say for education, because of Don's background and because I'm so interested in it, and when I really think of any success I've had in life, it would go back to reading at an early age, writing at an early age, being encouraged by my favorite school teacher, Mrs. Houck, and I hope her daughter Melissa's out there listening and playing rock and roll music in the area, who taught me and encouraged me to learn. And it's been the story of your life. It certainly was the story of Don's life till his second life in politics, but there's so many people out on the front lines that if we're going to change the country, change the direction, change the community, gosh, it really has to start with education. And it begins with people who care a lot and who drive a hard bargain, which is where I think you come in.
Absolutely. You know, as I look back, I've been in public education for 47 years. The last 8 years being on the business side of the district, those years previously walking into schoolhouses, either as a teacher or a principal. And there's nothing better than our youth. And they do need us to be able to pick them up and to be able to support them. And it does come with public education. And also comes with the principals and teachers who are in their schoolhouses. They need to have the resources that they deserve, and they can make their job a little bit easier and make our children's faces a little bit brighter.
Debbie, it's you and I have talked a lot about there's nothing like being around young people, making a difference in their lives, feeling that you're doing something important. And this journey that you've been on now for the past 8 years, educate folks. They probably are shocked. I mean, our folks, our listeners who are, you know, sitting at home listening to the podcast, or they're in the car and they're listening to it on Nestor's radio station, they probably don't even know that Baltimore County has a foundation. So sort of begin to walk us through the soup to nuts as to what the foundation is, what you all do, and why it matters.
Yeah, Debbie, I would say, what happened to Michael Phelps' mom, right? Like when he's swimming, right? Like, you pop up every couple, 4 or 3 years, whatever it is, and you're on TV, and everyone would... But I mean, this is a different platform because something did happen to you after you were Michael Phelps' mom, and I know it's a story worth telling because I've heard you tell it.
Well, you know, I was kind of plucked out of my schoolhouse, which I was a very happy principal at Windsor Mill Middle School with my teachers, my community, and my children. And I was put on the business side to take over a foundation that was founded in 1992. But even as a principal, I was not aware of it. So it has been around for several decades. But for the past 8 years, it has gone through a culture shift and a transformation. Our board is now a board of 36 business people, both nationally as well as local, who believe in public education. Some of them have children in our schools, and some of them have been graduate or are graduates of our schools. But the thing about it is, I look at us as the bridge between the school system and the community. My job each and every day is to go out and be a storyteller, and I tell stories of our schools. I tell stories of our principals and our teachers, and I share with them the demographics as to why we are out there asking for you to support our grant program, to enhance, to enrich, and to extend the academic success in the in the classroom. I ask you to support our scholarship programs, giving students the opportunity to go to college or to go into a career or a trade school, going that direction. Also, our apprenticeship program, those who have graduated from the district who want to become IT people, we do that. But also, our biggest initiative right now in partnership with Merit Companies and American Design is our teacher exchange, center called the Exchangery. We're taking on a national dilemma that we are going to embrace our 10,000-plus teachers and 115,000 students in Baltimore County with supplies that they need. So to kind of give you a little bit about it, 4 years ago, we started hosting school supply drives. One day, down and dirty, here you are. Come and get your supplies for your classroom for your students. We now have a center that we issue school supplies all year long. Teachers can come in and shop, and everything is free. We love that word, don't we?
Tell me what school supplies mean. I mean, I'm amongst two teachers here. I mean,
what does it look like in 2019?
Look, Aaron Mabin was in the city last year talking about just getting the heat put on, right? So we're talking about have and have not and have nothing to some degree. Bill Ferguson said he ran. You know, he's now part of the people running our state. That he ran because he was shoveling snow from the inside of his classroom. So, I mean, we've heard some horrific stories about all of this, but, I mean, are we talking Kleenex? Are we talking chalk? I mean, I don't know if they use chalk anymore, but you know what I'm saying. School supplies.
I know what you're saying. So when we talk about school supplies, we launch it the first day of summer, run it through Labor Day, and I'm talking about three-ring binders, markers, pencils, crayons, colored pencils, erasers, scissors, highlighters, post-it notes, pens, pencils, glue.
Elmer's glue, I was going to say.
Yeah, I mean, I'm talking about simple. I'm not talking about a computer in a child's hand or a whiteboard on a teacher's wall. I'm talking about basic supplies for kids to sit down and to be able to be successfully academically sound. You don't realize how long a pencil, how far it can go, and what it means to a kid.
So, I apologize for interrupting, but I want our listeners to understand. The teachers who come to the center, and you'll talk about where it is and how that happens, are they getting supplies for their children?
They are getting supplies for their children. We go through the teachers. So teachers come and shop for their children. They know who in that classroom needs those extra supplies. So we're going that direction, not the child to the schoolhouse, even though we just work with the Office of ESOL and provide them 180 book bags for our ESOL population stuffed with school supplies. Basic school supplies I'm talking about.
So this is literally a teacher, a third grade teacher, saying to a child in Highland Town who is an ESOL student, here, sweetie, here's a pen. Here's La Pluma,
yes.
Right here,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
Lapis,
yes.
La Pluma, right? Like,
yes.
I mean, because they don't have a pen, because their parents don't have paper for them, right? Literally?
Right. I mean, even our avid students in our school need 1 to 2 binders a day. We have offices that are purging binders, three-ring binders. We have given out over 2,200 binders to our avid students that people were going to throw away from their office buildings.
Wow.
So not only are we providing resources for our schools, but we're also saving the environment by repurposing and redistributing and recycling.
So we're saying to people out there that they can give these things to you, correct?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Nice, nice. Debbie Phelps is here. You know her as Michael Phelps' mom. Don knows her as a educator. Debbie, I take notes during these things because Don was one of my guidance counselor back in '82. Taught me how to take notes. You said something, and I almost stopped you, but you said we had 36 people together that all are believers. They believe in public education. I cannot fathom that there's somebody that doesn't believe in it to the point where they'd say, well, we got to quit on public education, right? Like, somehow that would be an answer. I'm a believer in public education because I was public educated at Dundalk High School by this guy and many, many others who propped me up. I know you're a big believer in it as well from your days at Windsor Mill backward, but finding believers in public education, which I'm going to serve this up on a platter for you and Don on Kerwin. We need to believe in public education because there's no second place for it.
And I'll tell you, I'll go on my Michael Phelps' mother's hat with Hillary and Whitney. So many times I was asked, what private school in Baltimore County does your son go? He doesn't go to a private school in Baltimore County. He goes to a public school because his mother is a public educator.
And Debbie, he had, believe it or not, and Nestor doesn't know this, he had and encountered one of Nestor's all-time favorite educators in Don Leifert.
Don Leifert educated Michael Phelps.
He was at Towson when Michael Phelps was there, and they actually got to know each other a little bit and had a nice relationship.
Did he teach him how to act like an Olympic
swimmer? I don't think Michael was in theater. I don't think he was in theater.
I think he was in the pool. Yeah. Don was my journalism teacher, and the reason I met Don Leifert was my journalism teacher. But Don Leifert, the reason I met him, and it took us doing this a couple of months for it all, the Freudian thing in the back of my brain, when I got my marching orders for 10th grade, all I ever wanted to be was a journalist, and I was not admitted into the journalism class, and my parents marched me down to the high school where Don Moeller, guidance counselor, met me at the front door and made sure that I followed the path of H.L. Mencken. And Debbie Phelps is here, the Education Foundation. Education Foundation. BCPS.org. Kerwin, I want you guys to...
Well, before we jump to Kerwin, I want to jump back to the supply thing. We'll get to Kerwin. But Debbie, are you all looking for people to donate to help with the supplies?
So, yes, donate, volunteer, participate, and host. But I want to tell you, gentlemen, that Tools for School is just one campaign at the Exchangery. Right now, we're doing Share the Warmth, hats, mittens, gloves, scarves, socks, Kleenexes, hand sanitizers, wipes. We're doing that all the way through January. And then in the spring, we're going to launch Books for Bins to impact the literacy with our children, being able to increase libraries in our school classrooms, or for having our teachers come and get those books to actually give to children, get them in their hands. So this is all donatable.
See, I don't think people know that stuff, Debbie.
No,
and that's why
it's amazing.
That's why we need you to be telling that story.
This stuff winds up in trash bins,
right,
literally, right?
Right. So here we are. It's the holiday season again, and you're talking about, hey, look, it's beyond pencils and markers and glue. We're talking mittens and coats and books. So tell me, I'm in my car now. I'm driving around out there. How do I get involved with the Education Foundation?
Well, first of all, we ask you to follow us on our social media platform. We're on Instagram, Twitter, as well as Facebook, my LinkedIn account, link it in with me with LinkedIn, or call our headquarters at 443-809-8962. Our administrative assistant will get everything taken care of for you, get you volunteering, get your donation picked up, or where you can drop it off. We have a very strong team, gentlemen, I'm very proud of, and we do great work for our students and teachers in Baltimore County.
Thanks, Debbie. Now, Nestor, you wanted to jump to Kerwin.
I want to jump to Kerwin. I want to go back to believing in public education, because we now have a governor finding dark money on weekends at casinos that were meant to be earmarked to make children brighter and our future brighter here. We're arguing about who's going to be the next mayor of the city and how the city relates to the state, and having a governor that, as a resident of Baltimore City, I don't feel like supports the city. You've been at this a long time, 40 more years than I, you know, than we could. For you, when you hear Kerwin, what do you think about the next generation of what needs to be done? Because I'm sure you have some pretty strong opinions about things that could be done to support education and locally, nationally, and just for every kid.
Well, you know, I look at our profession, which kind of hurts my heart when I say this. We're a dying profession. People do not want to become teachers, principals, superintendents. We are clamoring to be able to get opportunities to get teachers, all teachers of all colors, into our schoolhouses and to keep them there. I know as a principal, I would get a brand new teacher, and after 2 years, I say, Ms. Phelps, I'm done. I can't do this anymore. No, they need the resources. They need the art wraparound services around them to be able to support them, and they need a scale to be able to keep them in our schools.
Say wraparound services. Define that. I hear that a lot. And, you know, it always goes back to my own experience in the 1970s and 80s and going to school and what it was like to go to school and what the teachers went through, whether there was Kleenex in the room or whether I could drink from the water fountain or whether that fountain had cold water and that one had. I mean, these are things from 40 years ago. And then I walk in and see Dundalk High, which Don Jim Smith and Kevin Kamenetz built this palace of a high school that I see now. And I realize, boy, there's just some serious discrepancies between Aaron Mabin's school cool that he can't get the heat working and what's going on in Dundalk right now, where we have a beautiful, thank God, let each fellow join our chorus, echo far and near. But, you know, you want that for every kid. You do. And
you
Howard
do.
County's having the biggest fight ever about everything, right?
That's true, too, as well. But, you know, it starts from the top and getting a good, strong superintendent in that position who believes in the children, who believes in their teachers, who helps professionally develop their principals and to be able to professionally develop the teachers that they service. You know, I mean, if you don't support and mentor these young teachers, and I've done so many between the city and the county personally, a parent will call me and say, you know, Debbie, my daughter is in education and she's going to leave after 2 years. And sitting down and talking to them, she's like, I don't have the support. I don't have the resources I need.
I think it's 50%, Debbie. I think the stats that we had were 50% leave at the end of year two, which is pretty daunting.
So what you have is you have a principal in the schoolhouse who keeps on rebuilding these educators to what you want them to be able to deliver that instruction to your students. And all of a sudden, it's like, I'm leaving. Now, I know marriage and babies and things like that all get in, but they go and they change professions after they spent 4 years in institutions to be able to become a teacher.
Well, the promise of becoming a teacher is different than actually you know, it's romantic. You know,
right.
you romanticize what it is, and then you find yourself working at Baltimore City Public School, and it's different than, and maybe not even, you're being trained to educate, not being trained for all the other wraparound things, the other issues that are involved outside of how to figure out a math equation, right?
And we're going to be talking to Cheryl Bowe shortly, president of
great
MSEA,
woman.
About how hard this is. So shifting gears for just a quick second, Debbie, one of the things Nestor and I have heard a lot about over the past 9 months is the importance of job opportunities, and particularly the idea of apprenticeships. And that's something I think the foundation's involved in as well, right?
It is. You know, it's one of this thing that I've heard before, which I think is so important. All of our children will go to work, but all of our children will not go to college. It's taking a different direction for, do all of our kids need to go to college right out of high school? Do all of our kids need to go to college at all? There are great trades out there that they can go into that are very need. We need people in those trades. And I think, you know, as a former career and technology educator myself, being a home economist when I was in the classroom, that is all coming full circle now. Taking a look at the workforce development, how we're preparing our students for that too as well.
You are a home ed teacher?
I was, and I hate
to
cook.
Oh, I want to make cinnamon buns with you.
now they're talking about budgets.
You know, my mom still had a Singer sewing machine. My mom, you know, my mom was born
there
in 1919. So, I mean, I knew spindle. I knew how to work all that stuff, you know?
Debbie, cinnamon buns aside. What is the foundation doing, though? Paint us a picture to work with the business community to create these apprenticeships.
Well, we are working alongside the government, the governor, in doing this with his program that he has with Kelly Schultz, and that looking for people. We're looking for businesses to be able to say, yes, I want to bring an apprentice into my business. I want to train them. I want to work alongside with them with hopes. The hope is to hire them afterwards so they become into that position. I know that I'm going to, in fact, I'm at a conference right now for the school system. Leadership Advance in Hunt Valley. I'm going to go in and listen to Doug Handy and Michael Grubb pick up more information on the apprenticeship program, because we need to be able to celebrate the apprenticeships just like we celebrate a diploma from a college, or that we celebrate an athlete getting a full ride to a four-year institution to play ball.
Absolutely.
So we need to take a look at what we're doing here with our kids.
Absolutely.
Do we still, like, in home ec offer, like, I half kid you about cinnamon buns, but I remember I had...
It's making me hungry.
No, 7th or 8th grade, I think it was, when I went to middle school, you did, like, 8-week tours of home ec. You did early childhood, like how to be a parent.
Right.
You did cooking and, like, all that. Then you did wood shop,
right.
metal shop, and drafting. And you got a little tour, and I picked journalism, you know, worked out okay for me so far, but having those opportunities, You know, I even think about, we had Marty Schwartz on from Vehicles for Change. Perhaps you know him, Debbie, but he was talking about people coming out of incarceration and training them to work on vehicles and work on cars. Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking, in Don's era, a little older than me, there was a car shop.
Absolutely.
In the 70s, you could go to car shop. A lot of that's gone, right?
Yeah. Oh,
I think a lot of that's gone.
No, I think a lot of it's gone, and I think everything old's new again. Certainly Mike Rowe, who Debbie knows, and you hooked up with in Baltimore Homecoming.
Sure.
I mean, Mike's on a mission right now. Mm-hmm. Certainly, the president of your foundation, Tim Bojanowski, does phenomenal things out there at Zest Media Solutions. Tim is passionate about the need for this career tech and non-college educated opportunities.
Absolutely.
And very, very vocal.
He's the one that really oversees the apprenticeship program with the foundation. He might be a good person to have on to talk more about that.
We will get Tim on.
It's important. We're talking about all children. All children.
Deb, before we let you go, and I really appreciate you coming on to educate folks about the foundation, we can't let you go because a lot of our listeners, certainly with Nestor's background in sports, are sports moms and dads. They have young kids playing. Some of them have young kids playing that will be very good. A handful, not many, will have kids that will be an Olympian. Not so much about the celebrity of being an Olympic mom, but what did you learn about being the parent of athletes? Because your daughters were athletes as well, not just Michael. What did you learn, and what advice do you have for parents who have young kids who are athletes?
You know, it's such a dedication. But I really, my one encouragement is don't push your child into a sport because you like it. They have to have the heart for it. And, you know, as Hillary graduated, went off to college, as Whitney graduated, went off to college, I said to them, should I have done anything different for you guys growing up? Because they were swimming every day. They're like, no, Mom, it taught me so much. It taught me so many values that came out of the home to the pool. The work ethic, the dedication, the respect, the responsibility, the time management to be able to be who they are and what they did. You know, I look at Michael and I listen to his voice now as he's transitioned from a world-class athlete. For nearly 20-some years, he was on the international stage to what he's doing now with his advocacy work. It's pride, but you can't push kids into doing something if they don't want it. And I have to say, there were days that Michael did not want to go to pool. And I'd say, call your coach and tell him you're not coming. So putting accountability back on him.
How'd Bob handle that?
Well, Bob never got the call because Michael knew he didn't want to call Bob and say, I'm not coming to practice.
You know, I grew up with that, too. My dad would always say, he would call it a scratch, a day like when you wouldn't go to work. He said, I never scratch.
I never scratch,
you know.
Go ahead, Deb.
But at 14, it's like putting it back on him.
Sure. Yeah, perfect.
You know, he's getting up at 5:30, and he's like, I don't want to get out of bed. I've said, it's okay. I got it. Here's the phone. Pick up, and you call your coach. I know what your goals are. I know what you want to accomplish. So now it's back on you. I go downstairs, and I'd pray. Say, oh, please, God, get him up out of bed. I don't want to deal with Bowman. And next thing I knew, we were in the car, and we were going to the pool.
There you go.
My mom would have come with some cold water.
There you go.
No, wisdom.
Wisdom from Debbie Phelps. Debbie, one of the people just doing great work in the city, in the county, in the region. Again, how do folks reach out? Remind them again.
So please do call our headquarters at 443-809-8916. Talk to Ms. Whitcomb. Schedule a site visit at the Exchangery. Go on our website. You can make donations, and you can also volunteer. Step into our world and see who we are. We have great hearts because we have great children and great educators in our schoolhouses that need our help. So we're asking you to help us.
She is Deborah S. Phelps, leader, mentor, influencer, speaker, author, storyteller, and we have 284 mutual connections on LinkedIn, and I loved hanging out with you at Baltimore Homecoming, and I'm glad you made a little bit of time so we could learn about everything that's going on at the Education Foundation. Really appreciate you, Deb. Thanks for coming on.
Debbie, thanks so much.
Debbie Phelps.
Happy holidays. You
too.
Happy holidays to you. Drink more eggnog. Debbie Phelps joins us here from the Education Foundation of Baltimore County. Don Moeller and I doing some Baltimore positive and getting through the holidays here. We're going to be back at State Fair soon. We're going to be back at Jennings Cafe in Catonsville and, of course, down at Faithley's at Lexington Market when I return with Police Commissioner Harrison. Check out the whole schedule up at BaltimorePositive.com. Getting ready for the holidays. We're back for more and more episodes, including episode number 100 with Don Moeller. Moeller and I, 100 episodes in. How's he putting up with me? We are WNST.net, AM 1570, WNST Towson, Baltimore, and we never stop talking. Baltimore positive.